love you. You are our God. You are our Savior. You are our provider and protector. You are the one who loves us more than we can even begin to fathom. And so we have gathered together in your name to offer you worship and thanksgiving and praise. Anything else our and laughter and anything else our hearts can do. Fill this place with your Spirit, Lord. Fill our hearts with your Spirit. Lift us up so that we can lift up your name. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Good morning. We, 11 of us just got back last night from a week in San Francisco, and this morning is, in a sense, dedicated to celebrating what the Lord did while we were there. And I'll tell you what, after a week, there is so much to celebrate, which is just awesome. And but as we, and you might notice that at least 11 of us are kind of looking a little woozy and very tired and bumping into things. So just kind of ignore that. And we'll all get a chance to share a little bit this morning, which is just part of our celebration of the faithfulness of our God. So in the meantime, just want to touch base on a couple of very quick announcements. You'll notice on your bulletin Wednesday at 6 p.m. we have a deacons meeting listed. Deacons have been meeting earlier, but one of our wonderful deacons is now employed at a different job, and so her hours are a little different. And so we have set 6 p.m. as a meeting time. So this is probably news to some of our deacons, so that's why we're telling you now. We kind of finally figured out that we needed to make that adjustment. So 6 p.m., deacons, Wednesday, be there if you're a deacon. Also, next Sunday, worship, children's Sunday school, that's all going on. It's going to be great. I will not be there next Sunday, or here, I should say. I will be there, but I will not be here. Myself, the Boyson family, and the Civic family will be in Denver, Colorado, celebrating the wedding of Heather Civet and her fiancé, Ben, and I get to officiate that, which is wonderful. So we will be away for that. But if you remember, I had a young buck here several months ago, a guy named Cody Gold, who is a dear friend of mine, and I just think the world of this young man, and I asked him if he would just jump in and share with us, and he was thrilled. So he will be here to share the word with us next week. So we'll be in good hands. The only other thing I want to just focus on and mention is just there under the announcements, the Women's Bible Study. It's not for another bit, but we'll be putting an order in fairly soon. So if you are interested in this Bible study, it's going to be awesome. Nehemiah is a often neglected but very powerful book, and what a great thing to study. So, and Kelly Minter will do a great job. Do please sign up and let us know so that we can put the order in and have everything here and ready to go. All right. Do we have? It's really early in the game at this point, but do we have a sign-up sheet for the all church sort of picnic?
No, I wasn't home. Sorry.
What were you doing? anyway, okay. Well, that'll be coming. It's a month away. So, oh my goodness. Excuse me. I meant oh. Speaking of a month away, but not away, but right now, it just dawned on me. Yesterday, officially today, we'll say kind of, is my 16th anniversary of being the pastor here. Sweet 16. Sweet 16. I was sharing this with some of the folks at YWAM, and I just said, sweet 16, never been kissed. And I'm like, I have three children. So, anyway. Okay. That's it. Do we need to say anything else for announcements? Anything? Sleep deprivation. Don't worry about it. Just let it go. Anything else? Good. All right. Oh, Beth. Yes.
I just wanted to thank you all for your prayers and for their expertise in the business. My house might be sold. Woo! And here to help me get ready are my two sisters, Sandy and Carol, and their husbands, Wayne and Mike. So thank you.
Labor of love.
Now appreciate prayers for a house to move into.
That's an important step in the process. Yeah, we will be. We have been and will be praying for that.
Absolutely. So
good. Anything else? All right. In my rather befuddledness this morning, totally forgot about a call to worship. So receive this as a call to worship from Psalm 95. The first seven verses. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it. And the dry land which his hands have formed. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Yeah. All right, let's worship together.
In that spirit, let's stand together and loudly praise and dance and sing and just get crazy worshiping God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. demon will drink the rain. He'll turn the flame to clouds. And many men will hear you speak. They will never turn around. I will not forget you. Are my God like me? With a thankful heart I bring my offering and my sacrifices, not what you can give, but what I alone can give to you. A grateful heart I give, a thankful prayer I pray, a dance of praise I dance before you. A loud song I sing, a huge bell I ring, a life of praise.
Creation
Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with souls? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable. Awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are.
Team come up and share in just a few minutes, and I wanted to share things not directly specifically about our experiences this morning, but about why we went, and so I don't want to go on and on and on for very long, but there was just some things that I thought were touching on. And looking at Luke 15, 1 through 10 is just a great way to kick it off. So let's look at what our Lord has to say. Hear the word of the Lord. Now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So Jesus told them this parable. He said, "Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has
found it. He lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. It's the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Precious Lord, we do give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks with all of our hearts that you are a God who wants to be known, who wants to share himself with us, and who wants to share his heart with us so that we can share in his heart. You are glorious. And we want to know you, and we want to share in you, and we want to follow you. Bless us as we ponder your word together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, so as we have been saying, 11 of us spent the last week in San Francisco. And it truly was an incredible time. We were working with what is usually known as YWAM. Carrie and I were plotting an alternative organization called MAWAM, which would be middle-aged with a mission. But YWAM... YWAM is Youth with a Mission, and it is an outstanding organization. And we spent a week reaching out to the poor and to the homeless in an area of San Francisco known as the Tenderloin, which has an incredibly high concentration of the poor and the homeless. And we did what we could do to extend the love and the blessings of Jesus Christ, and to do that to people who desperately need to receive the love and the blessings of Jesus Christ. And when I tell you that it was an awesome week, I'm using the term literally. At least in my own heart, it was awe-inspiring. It was so meaningful. It was so significant. And at times, it was even fun. It was wonderful because it strengthened our relationships together. It strengthened our relationships with the YWAM staff. It strengthened our relationship with a number of people there on the streets in the Tenderloin. And it strengthened our relationship with Jesus Christ. So that's pretty awesome. But here's the thing. Our trip was anything but easy. Amen? Amen. Our trip was anything but convenient. First of all, a number of our team had to take time off from work. Students and adults alike. That was money that they were not earning. That was a hassle getting shifts covered. That wasn't easy. It wasn't convenient. Also, as much as I love YWAM, their accommodations are not exactly posh. You wouldn't use that word. There's other words. We slept on squeaky, shaky, metal-framed bunks in our sleeping bags. And literally, if I breathed, it went... In the middle of the night, when nature called, you had to go through a very loud squeaky door and walk up two flights of stairs to even get to the bathrooms. And the bathrooms and the showers were only available, at least for the guys, but for all of us, at very odd times. And the food was actually great, right? Yeah. We had Kevin and his new wife, Lillian, working and running the kitchen and for the dinner. We actually had some really delicious food. But then we had to clean the dishes and the kitchen and the bathrooms and pretty much everything else. So, and the thing is, in all honesty, the Tenderloin of San Francisco is a difficult place to be. When you are in the Tenderloin, you are literally surrounded, literally permeated by the stench of human waste and human decay. Hardcore drug deals and drug use is going on all around you all the time. And the people that we are reaching out to are a broken people who are lost in darkness, many of them in addiction. Some of the people that we interacted with are just delightful people, wonderful people, so affectionate, so appreciative. Many others are angry, are manipulative, are clinically psychotic. Our going to San Francisco really was not convenient. It wasn't easy. It was hard. And it was exhausting on so many levels. So why? Why did we go? Why would you, as our church family, be so supportive of us going? Why would you sponsor a significant portion of the expenses for us to go? Why would you donate for Bibles to give out while we were there? Why would you send us down with literally hundreds of pairs of socks, praise God? Why would any of us go through the inconvenience of the past week? There's one word that really does sum it all up. The word love. And not just our love. Infinitely more significant than whatever love we could come up with is the love of Jesus Christ. Because first of all, it is the love of Jesus Christ that is transforming us. I was going to say, like, past tense, like, transformed us, but, you know, it's an ongoing process, isn't it? The love of Jesus Christ is transforming us. It is doing a work in our lives. It is moving us out of darkness and into light. It is changing us slowly but surely from being focused on ourselves to being focused on God. And it is the love of Jesus Christ that is transforming the way that we see each other, the way that we value the people around us, especially the people that we don't normally value, the people that we would normally ignore, or maybe even resent, maybe even despise, maybe even reject. One of the most profound things that Jesus showed us is that God really does love everybody. Every single human being on this planet. Not just the rich and the beautiful. Not just even the good and the righteous. God loves everyone. The whole Bible shows us that God has a special place in his heart for the poor, for the broken, for the lost and the marginalized and the despised. Jesus showed us God's love for the unlovable. God wants so desperately for them to know it. This morning I chose those two little parables out of Luke 15. They're really a set of three, which is nice, and you get like silverware and no, I'm just kidding. There's a set of three. The lost sheep, the lost coin, and then the lost son, right? The prodigal son.
The Prodigal Son is really long, to be honest, and so I didn't think I should read all of those, so you're welcome. But I didn't need to, because the first two really get to the point. The point is two things that these parables show us. Two things that are so profound and so important, so essential for us to embrace. And the first is the value that Jesus says that God places on the lost. When the lost sheep was found, the shepherd throws a party. He says to his friends, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." And Jesus tells us, "Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 of the righteous who need no repentance." It's incredible value. And then he tells that story about the woman who finds her lost coin. And she said to her friends and neighbors, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that was lost." And then she throws a party, which is so hilarious, because the party cost more than the coin that she had lost was worth in the first place. Didn't matter. Because Jesus says, "Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." God loves and values all of his creation. There's some really wonderful scriptures that talk about that. But there's no getting around the fact that the Word tells us that God values humanity most of all. He longs for them and he celebrates when each one is saved, when each one is brought home into his loving arms. Which brings us to the second thing that these parables shows us: the fact that God is willing to go out of his way to seek and save the lost. When one sheep out of 99 was lost, Jesus tells us that the shepherd goes on a journey. And he was determined to go, and I love the word, until he finds his lost sheep. And when one coin was lost, the woman literally turns her house upside down, searching and searching, and again, until she finds that lost coin. These parables show us very active images. The image of someone who is willing to work hard, willing to step out of their comfort zone, willing to sacrifice their convenience to win the prize. Jesus showed us this truth in his own life. One of my favorite things that Jesus does in the Gospels is in Mark 4 and 5. And it was after a time of intense teaching, and in the midst of that intense conflict with the authorities. And Jesus and his disciples get into a boat, and they cross the sea, and along the way there's this fierce storm. We know the story. Everybody's freaking out, and Jesus is asleep, which is awesome. Jesus has to miraculously still the wind and the waves to save them. And he gets to the other side and he meets up with one man. One man who is horribly tormented. One man who confesses that he has a legion of unclean spirits riling around inside of him. And Jesus casts those demons out and he restores the man to wholeness. And he turns around and gets in the boat and goes back. The story of Legion is a story of inconvenient love. Jesus was willing to go through all kinds of trouble for one man. And of course, we know the whole gospel about the most inconvenient love of all, don't we? 1 John 4:10 says, "In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins." Jesus came to earth
Jesus took on our humanity. Jesus offered himself up on the cross for us. He took our sins upon himself because he loved us, because he loved each one of us that much. Because he loves each and every one of the folks in the Tenderloin of San Francisco that much. And he desperately wants each one of us to know it. So that's why. That is why we traveled and worked and helped out the folks in San Francisco. Because we were willing to love them with an inconvenient love. And we know that we love them because Jesus, who loves us so much, loves them with a passionate, desperate, sacrificial love. And it is an honor and it is a joy to share in that love with him and to share that love with those who need it the most. I'm so thankful for our team. And I'm so thankful for our time together and for the ways that we got to shine the light of Jesus Christ. And I'm so thankful for you, for the love that you gave us, for the prayers that you said on our behalf, for the socks and the cookies and the Bibles, and for the funds that you were willing to invest in this good work. And all of this has been a beautiful and powerful expression of the love of Jesus Christ. And the life that he has called us to. May he continue to bless us. May he continue to bless YWAM San Francisco and his precious, precious children in the Tenderloin. Amen?
Amen.
I'm just going to have our team come up. Hopefully we've got enough room up here.
So, YWAM, assemble. We do have a little microphone, so I think we can stand up here.
Yeah.
I believe the mic is hot. The mic is hot. It's hot. It's hot. So we all talked about how a joy it would be to be able to share some of our hearts and experiences, just to give witness to what Jesus was doing. Time there, so that's what we're gonna do. Okay. Got a hot mic? Anybody?
Who wants to break the ice?
Who wants to break the ice?
Good job, Jack.
Jack.
So this was a very intense week for all of us, and great week, and we did a lot of great work, but very intense. And but the positive was through all the intensity, we were all very united. It was a very small group this time, and we were all very, very close. And whenever some shocking thing happened, we were all there for each other and there to back each other up. And I saw everyone here be incredibly strong in face of adversity. And yeah, it was really cool to see all of us kind of unite and go and spread God's love. So. So thank you all for being with me on this trip.
So it was very intense, as Jack said, and yet, like, God used those intensities, and it was kind of in every realm it was intense, and from good to bad, you know, I mean, it was intense goodness, and then at the same time, intense evil and weirdness around us, but at the same time, God used all of that to teach us and find us, and to kind of speak to us about his way and the way of truth and goodness and love, and truly, it just, I don't know, renewed, at least for me, the love of God and the love of Christ and just appreciation for him and for his goodness and for just, he's wonderful. And just talking to these people, they're desperate for that perfect love and that perfect balance in their dark place, and then when you just would show them that love, they would just blossom under it. From just this one man who at first was acting seemed all tough, and I was eating lunch with him, and then he just turned and told me his whole story and just cried and wept, and he was just so thankful and so loving and so gentle to us, and he was just this big man who, I think, Vlad said he was like on the street, you know, he would have been terrified of him, but, and then there's just this big guy who was on the street, and we were walking past him, and we talked to him, and he wanted to tell us a story, tell us his name, and he was just so loving, and, you know, again, he blossomed, and it just was fascinating to see how powerful love is. And even with our own team, you know, we all, as Jack said, we had each other's back, and that was so amazing. So at times when it was so dark or hard or so overwhelmingly good and powerful, each of us were able to support each other and love one another. And it was just a huge blessing. So.
I'm trying to find the right distance. Okay. You know, one of the things that truly amazed me was the Tenderloin is like this small little area that's just kind of a couple blocks in every direction. And then you just walk those couple blocks and you are in the middle of San Francisco, and it's Market Street, it's all the fancy shops and all the fancy people in their fancy suits, and you know, it's like crazy. I mean, you leave a world full of drugs and alcohol and addiction, and people have left trash on the street, people have gone to the bathroom on the street, and a few blocks over, you know, you're buying Starbucks, and you're at, you know, Forever 21 or whatever, you know, not me personally, but other people, and it was so crazy, because these people that, you know, you would usually see and almost be afraid of, and really, we're so much nicer than the people you saw on the streets, on Market Street, that had everything in the world, and it was just, it blew you away, you know, because these people who had reasons to be angry and had reasons to be mean were so much more nice, or so much nicer than you could ever imagine, and you would walk on Market Street and people would just, they wouldn't even make eye contact, they wouldn't say hello, you know, and another thing,
just off of what Wyatt was just saying, it's such a powerful thing when you give someone love and respect, how they respond to that. And it's true, I mean, none of us would ever approach these folks here. I mean, it was really intense. I mean, heroin was being shot up outside of our YOM windows. The level of drugs and crack, and I mean, doing laundry last night, I didn't realize how badly we stunk until I began doing the laundry, and I was like, I'd open a bag, and I, you know. But when you would bend down and offer that person hot chocolate, the response that you got, and I was like, I'm curious. And they have a name, and they are precious to someone. These are someone's sons and daughters. And one of the gentlemen that Zoe was referring to, Jimmy. Jimmy, what was it? Jack? Basketball. He was a pro basketball player. And he said, I slid into the dark. And but he and his wife in the wheelchair camped out. They slept outside of the Wyoming building and swept the steps. And every day, they started sober up, didn't want socks, didn't want anything to do with us. And by the end, it was literally nonstop hugs and crying. And we were encouraging him to clean up and go coach basketball at the Boys and Girls Club. But just the relationship that developed. I mean, he gave us so many hugs and just cried openly. And I mean, what love does, it transforms us. And to get to go through that, it was such a privilege. And Wyatt was right. They all tried to give us love back. They really did. Over and over, they were like, be careful. Don't go down this street. And we would pray for them, and then they'd even pray for us or thank God for us. Or we'd see them the next day, and the first thing they'd say was, I thanked God when I was sleeping last night for you guys, that you came. I mean, it just, it was so humble. You're like, you know, is that what
you're about?
Yeah,
in
my
office.
Okay.
we
all the time.
Yeah. When we first went to the trip, we had like a little talk and we did like a neighborhood survey and stuff. And then they did a lesson about how we were serving the people like Jesus served when he was on earth. People who were sick, people who were homeless. And it was really an eye-opener because you think when you read the Bible that it wasn't like the people that we saw every day on the streets. It was a really interesting experience to see them through that light instead of seeing them as homeless people or drug addicts or alcoholics, as just as the people that Jesus would have loved and served if he was right there next to you. And so it was really interesting to view it all through that light instead of the usual way we look at them. And the sad thing is, when you fall into addiction or just that lifestyle, it's almost impossible to get out of it, especially when you're in the Tenderloin. And so they would talk about how like they wanted to get jobs and wanted to leave, but they just couldn't. They didn't have an address, they didn't have a phone, so there's no way for them to get out of it. When we usually would think if someone's homeless that they're just lazy or something like that, but they're not. They're people who really want to have a better life than they do. And that's why it was so great to work with YWAM, is they're giving them that chance every day. And so that was really good.
So one of the things we did was the homeless plunge, and that's where we were homeless for a day. Like, towards the end, I was like thinking, yay, but it's almost done, we can go back to YWAM and sleep tonight. And then I was thinking, wait, for like the people on the streets, they don't have that like, oh yay, I'm done in 30 minutes, oh now 20 minutes. And so it was like, oh wow. And it was really boring. For like, and like just having nothing to do all day.
I just have to say, Jack and Ashley and Elizabeth and I, we were a team of four on the homeless plunge, and Jack would not allow us to do, well, we went onto the plunge, and then our group, out of the 60 YWAM student missionaries that were there, we were the only group that slept on the floor in the big Ellis room, which is by the entrance with all glass windows. So all night long, we were awoken to police sirens and cussing and fighting, and none of us had ever woken up to cussing before. That was that reality, and it was, we were, anyway, we slept girls on one side and guys on the other side, and, but it was, so we had not slept all night. We were kicked out at 6 in the morning, and then we had big adventures. We had a beautiful thing, which hopefully one of the students will share, but, and then we had to find our meals at shelters, and, but Jack made a rule we couldn't do anything that a homeless person couldn't, because I was like, let's sit on this bench. Jack's like, they're going to let you because you're a nice mom that looks dirty, but they would not let a homeless person, and so he walked us, like, how many hours? So we walked all day, like, and he wouldn't let us leave the Tenderloin either. So it was awesome. I have to say, it was so good. We all were so thankful that Jack, like, was, he made us abide by the rules, didn't let us use bathrooms at Starbucks. No, he was like, I was like, I have money, let's get on a bus and ride a bus for 2 hours, we can sit down. And they wouldn't let me.
Temporary fix, they would feel better, and that was awesome. I love doing that. But you
kind of struggling with that. And then, you know, we met a guy on one of our trips out on the street. His name was Thomas. And Thomas was in a wheelchair, and we noticed that one of his legs had an infection from here all the way up his leg to here. Like, skin was, it was like oozing, and flies were all over it, and he couldn't stand up. I mean, he could barely stand up. And we started talking to him, and Ashley kind of saved the day. She had been to a free health clinic the day before, where they provide free health care, free treatments for homeless people and people who need it that can't afford it. And we got this idea. She's like, "Let's go. Let's get in there." And it was like 8 blocks away. He was in a wheelchair that had its foot rest stolen in his sleep because he was alone. People would steal from him in his sleep, and kick his wheelchair as they went by. And so it was really, really awful. And so we couldn't move him because his foot was so swollen, it would just cause great pain to move him, and it was 8 blocks. And so me and Ashley were sprinting down the streets because it was like 3 o'clock, and they closed at 4. 3:30. And it was crazy because it took us like an hour and a half to convince Thomas to go to the clinic. And finally, we're sprinting down the streets, and we get to the clinic, and the one guy, we find a wheelchair, and we ask if we can bring it. You know, we're like, "Can we bring this guy?" And the front desk lady's like, "Well, no, we're closed. It's 3:30. It's past closing." And we had a second there that was pretty intense. My heart dropped because I thought in that moment, there's no way. I mean, we spent an hour and a half trying to convince this guy, and there was no way I was going to be able to go back and tell him that we couldn't help him and that he had to stay there and we couldn't do anything. But Ashley, when she was there the day before, she had met the head doctor, Alyssa. The head nurse. And she came out and she was like, "What do you guys need?" So we had this guy who needs medical attention. And she said, "Sure, bring him." I was so excited in that one moment. I can't believe it. I was like, "Oh, my God." So we got the wheelchair and we sprinted back and we got Thomas in the wheelchair and we brought him to the health clinic. And they started working on him even though they were closed. Found out he had to go to the hospital, it was so funny because the whole time he was so lighthearted. I mean, he was so happy that he was here. He was cracking jokes. One of the guys who worked there, June, he didn't have a lot of hair, and Thomas had just big, massive hair. I mean, it was awesome, and he just kept making fun of June, and everybody was laughing. While we were with him, he had told us about how he was a dancer, and he was on Vegas, and people would line up and film him, and he would listen to classic rock. And he would be in his own world, and how he was super nice. So I ended up calling him my golden-hearted dancer, but anyway, eventually they called the paramedics, and he ended up leaving. It was nice knowing that we had helped him, but it was still tough because it was almost time to leave. We were leaving in a day or two. So you were left with that question, is he going to be okay? Is he going to keep coming back to the clinic to get help? And it was just in the back of my mind. And then Friday night, we come back. The next day, we come back. And Mark had seen Thomas on the streets. And we were like, "Oh my gosh, we gotta go see him," you know? So me, Ashley, Brian, Mark, and Eric, we all ran out on the streets. We walked like with flies, who couldn't even stand up, or was walking up and down the streets with his wheelchair. And we were so excited to see him. And he told us, he's like, when I got there, the infection in my leg was, the disease was in my blood. He was going to die pretty soon. But he was fine now. As long as he kept going, he was going to be okay. His life was going to be fine. It was so, so awesome to see him walking. Like, you can't believe. Ashley was on him the whole time. She told him, she's like, you better go to that clinic because we will be back. And we will find you. And if your leg is gone, I'm going to be so angry. And you know, it was dark outside and it was getting dangerous, so we had to go back. And we all gave him hugs. And we actually have a picture of him. I'm sure eventually we'll hang it up and you all get to see him. But that was just awesome, because I feel like, you know, I was struggling with that, we were only temporarily fixing, and I think God heard that, and he's like, here you go, you, Ashley, and Brian have pretty much saved this guy's life, and that was an awesome experience. I will never forget that, and next time we go back, I will be looking for Thomas.
Someone make the story longer. Talk about it. So the thing about Thomas is that he was just such a genuine person, and I mean, you never know officially, but I do believe that he really wasn't addicted to any drugs, any hardcore drugs. He might have been an alcoholic, and he may have had a hard life, and however he got there, but he wasn't, and he was there, and his mind was there, and he was such a genuine person, and we sat there talking to him for literally an hour and a half, trying to convince him to get to the free clinic to get his foot looked at and clean. And he never didn't want to go. He just was like, he always would change the subject. He'd bring it up, and he'd talk about something completely off what we were talking about multiple times, and it was just so funny trying to get him back to it, because he was there. He knew what we were doing. We were trying to get him to go. And so every time we brought it back, he knew exactly, like, we were trying to switch the conversation back. And he knew what we were doing, and he respected it. And he understood that we were there to help him and why we were there to help him. And one of the most genuine things is that when we did find him the second time, when he was released from the hospital, he understood why we were there. We were sent there from God. Like, he understood, and the first thing he said to us was, like, he saved his life. And he looked at us all and he said, you saved my life. Like, they told me that it was so bad, the infection was in my blood. And he said that he'd been praying for us since he got out of the hospital. So he did. He understood that we were there from God. And he just was like, I'll pray for you all the time. And it was really hard to leave him. It was especially hard to leave him when we got to say bye to him when he was in the ambulance going to the hospital the first day. And it was really, really, really hard having to leave him, and like why I was saying, like, not knowing what's going to happen next. Because we would leave and come back and just never know. Like, if we wouldn't have met him the second day, we wouldn't have known that he had infection in his blood, and that we did save his life or have a huge part in his life being saved. And it's just amazing. Like, what are the odds? You really don't. Like, he came back from the hospital and we found him again in a completely different area. And it was amazing. And it was God's work laid right on her knee. Like, it was truly amazing.
And he kept saying the reunion was so sweet to witness. Mark was kind of our bodyguard because of the drug bills. He was like trying to be big. And then I was like walking the street, like being a prayer person. And then, but then over and over. over and over. If we hadn't met Alyssa the day before through a weird connection trying to get a wheelchair for another guy, for Sam, we never would have learned about the clinic, and we wouldn't have built a trust relationship with this amazing nurse, because she let us take a $200 wheelchair out and down 8 blocks, and we were trained twice. She trusted us. But actually, we didn't even know where to get a wheelchair at that in the general line. So it was just God really did it. And then for Thomas to keep proclaiming over and over, God was sent. And no God sent. So it was so
I just find it so interesting. We go out and we're like, oh, we're going to share this love and just try to send some positivity to all these people. And you're in this like dark, awful, awful place where horrible things are going around. And it's kind of hard while you're there not to like get down about it, because it's so horrible and these people are like stuck in this place. And you're on the streets and you're trying to help these people, and you come across some people who are kind of like, no, I don't want your help, like, I'm fine. But then you come across some of these people that are just, like, lights in all this darkness, and they're so beautiful, and I think it's so amazing how they can even share God's love when they're stuck in all the darkness and awful things going on. And I think that's just, I don't know, something really beautiful that I have seen multiple times going down there.
So I'll try to be quick. So we did some unbelievable, awesome stuff. And, you know, Danica, you're right. It is a horrible, brutal place to experience. And we go there knowing that we're going to share the love of Christ, but it's really temporarily, like Wyatt was saying, you know, we give a hygiene kit and it's gone. And we give Hocho and it's a celebration of just joy, of something you don't need, but it's just fun. And for Brian's, like, his sermon today about finding the lost coin or the lost sheep, you know, that's honestly what we're really there to do, is we're there to teach people about Jesus. And we did that through our love. We did that through the Bibles that you bought for us. And we just did that through conversation. And one of the joys I had is we were at this lady's funeral memorial place. It was called, her name was Fancy. And her friend Rhonda and Mousy were enjoying that. And so we're sitting there talking with them, having some Hocho, and Kimberly walks by, and Kimberly shared the story that she was on the street for 28 years, but one of the YWAMers down the street from the church down the street, she said, talk to her about Jesus. And she's clean, she has a house, she has a job, and then her brother's like stops by, and he's got 2 jobs and a house, and he's off the streets. And it was from people going and sharing the gospel and sharing Jesus Christ. And then we got to share the gospel message with Rhonda and her friends. And, you know, later that next night we met Felicia again for the second time, who 7 months clean off of needles, you know, through the love of Christ. And so we got to actually see through all the hard things we experienced this week. And I encourage you guys to ask us when we go in there of specific stories of, you know, things we did, because we did a crud load of stuff. Just how we really impacted, how we really brought Christ, how we really shined in that neighborhood. I mean, we had the homeless plunge, the hygiene kits, the Hocho, but we did prayer walks. What else did we do? We did all kinds of stuff.
The cafe.
The Gubbio Cafe, which was unbelievable. It was awesome. So if somebody wants to share Gubbio, that'd be awesome.
So there's this church, St. Boniface, and it's the most beautiful church I've ever seen. And we walked in there the first time last time we were there. And we walked in, and was it during our homeless plunge?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And we walked in, and we heard a bunch of snoring. And so we looked, and there's all these beautiful stained glass windows, and it's a Catholic church, and it's beautiful. And then we look, and in all the pews are all these homeless people sleeping. Just bunch of them, sleeping and resting and praying. And we went in there again on this time because we loved it so much. We made a connection with the church, and so we went in and brought breakfast to them, and so they would wake up and come and eat with us. And it was really a beautiful experience, and we attended Mass there. And I think it's just a reminder of, we there's a lot of these non-Christian programs that are sharing a lot of food and giving a lot of really things that aren't needed on the streets. People are literally dying, just composing right in front of us, really bad. But here was this beautiful Christian outreach program that just lets people come in and rest under crosses and candles, and just it's beautiful. I think it's important to remember Jesus was homeless. He hung out with homeless people and prostitutes, and those were the people he surrounded himself with and shared with. And this, there can be elitism. You know, it's easy to look at the people and see, oh, there's all these drug deals going on, or oh, there's, look at all these needles on the ground, and there was a lot of them. People smoking crack all over. I've never really thought that I wanted to smell cigarette smoke, because there's so much crack smoke. So I think it's important to remember that we are Christians, we are supposed to be like Christ, and here was this beautiful program that really had people come in and just give a true home of rest and safety to these people in a Christian church. It was beautiful. So it really touched me, and I think it touched a lot of us. And so we gave them muffins and coffee and hot chocolate and talked to them. Mom and I went to the front and talked with a lot of people. Really, some people working really hard and some people just enjoying drug use. Some mix, but the people working really hard are working really hard, and it's really hard to escape the system. So, but here was a church that was helping them do that. So, that's beautiful. Yeah. Right.
One of the special things was it was called the sacred sleep, because, and we, I mean, it was, people said they just cannot sleep on the streets. I mean, it's just not safe. You get robbed, raped. I mean, it's really not safe. So the church opens at 6 in the morning, and they sleep there until, I think, 3:30. Mm-hmm. And they open bathrooms to them, and there are these beautiful, sweet people that come and just give them shoulder rubs. There was like a table in the back to have a sacred touch, like to not be violated or any violence towards them, but just like a, you're okay, you're a human. And it was so beautiful. We were so touched last time we got in touch with them and said, how can we serve you while we're down there? And our students really wanted that. When we had meetings before the trip, they said, we want to do something for them. And so it was really neat. Their director, Jose, we had time with him, but the main director that runs the floor every morning of the church and somehow gets all these folks to get along and not have fights over pews and stuff, her name was Tina. And she wore this big cross, and she loved Jesus. And during the homeless plunge, I used their bathroom because it was for homeless people. So I went back and used their restroom, and she saw me, and she began to cry and said, your students, she said, we have people come in and serve these morning cafes. But she said, your students came with the love of Jesus. And she said, they talked. She said, a lot of people are like, here, you know. But she said, your student group was the best group we've ever had. They talked, and they loved, and they introduced themselves, and they shook hands. And it was, and she said, I feel so encouraged about the work I'm doing after your group came. So that was a really neat thing. And when we met, we hooked up with some City Impact people, because when we were homeless, we went to one of their worship services. You go to worship, you get coffee and donuts. So it's mandatory worship, which we were kind of. And so, but we actually made, but to get, and that's how we met Alyssa, the medical director, who's a nurse working with all volunteer Christian doctors and nurses in the Tenderloin running this clinic. It's incredible. And, I mean, but, and that's when we met the nuns. We had lunch at a place where these beautiful nuns served people, and that was awesome. Who ate at the nuns? I think a bunch of us ate at the nuns. The nuns, because someone else on the homeless thing told us, that was the best place to get it. They're like, if you want good cooking, go to the nuns. And they piled these plates, and it was amazing. So, but to see, we got to branch out from YWAM, who we loved, the YWAMers. But we got to see, we had total fellowship with all these different Christian groups. It's like we had church right there in the Tenderloin over and over. old man on the corner some hot chocolate, and then he turned out he had a bag of rosaries, and he was there to give out rosaries from another Catholic church in town. So he gave us a rosary, we gave him hot chocolate, and then two more Catholics came. So we all ended up having a total church in the corner. It was awesome. They gave me all these rosaries to my students. So then I began passing out rosaries, because when I gave out hot chocolate, he was sweet. Homeless gentleman was like, can I have a rosary? I'm like, yes. It was so neat to meet all these servants of God. They were there, like, genuinely loving people in the name of Jesus. Really radical. And we met, I mean, how many times did we meet people that had been heroin addicts for 26 years, and then they encountered God because someone was there at the right moment and prayed with them, and they went, I'm going to die if I don't just change. You know, it was really, things aren't happening. God's on the move.
One of my favorite things about not only this trip, but all the other trips I've been on, is how thankful they are when you just talk to them. Or like hand them a cup of hot chocolate or a hygiene kit or socks or something. I mean, there's some who are kind of grumpy about it and stuff, but then you get the ones who are just so thankful. And Grace and I handed a hygiene kit to this one man, and there was a few guys who we handed these hygiene kits to, and two of them just kept talking to us about the weather and all this random stuff. And this one guy, he just kept coming up to us. He's like, thank you so much. God bless you. You girls are angels. And there was a few of those guys who I met throughout the Tenderloin, but it's just so rewarding for myself, and it's just awesome to see how much you impact them when they thank you over and over again, and it's just awesome to go out and serve and be like, have that thanks to you. I mean, I love going out and serving all the people, and not only just like the grumpy ones, but the thankful ones. It's just awesome to see the ones that are really thankful.
All right. Thank you very much for letting us share our hearts. And as you can tell, we could go on a lot longer, but we're not going to. Mark mentioned, you know, fellowship, coffee hour. Let's hang out a little bit, and if we can, you know, schedule-wise and all that. But if you want to know more, I'm sure you could get us to say more. But let's pray, and we're going to actually streamline the rest of our time amazingly well. So let's pray together right now as our whole prayer time. Lord, thank you for you. We know that we love because you first loved us. And we thank you that you loved us, and we thank you that you have planted your love within us. And we thank you that we got to be a part of your love being poured out on people who need it so dearly. And we thank you that we continue to get to be a part of your love with each other, with our brothers and sisters in Christ, with those who are lost, with each and every one we meet, because you love each and every one we meet so dearly. Lord, there's so much to give you thanks for. Thank you for your strength, for your protection, for your guidance, for the many miracles that we got to see this week, that we got to be a part of this week. Thank you for the love and support and prayers that surrounded us every step of the way. And Lord, as we went out and kind of far away to serve those in need, we know that there are so many needs with our own community, with our own church, with our own town, with our own, just all around us. And Lord, as we hold those in our minds and our hearts and lift them to you right now, we just ask that you would receive our needs, and that we would be able to see you act so lovingly and powerfully and beautifully. And Lord, all this we lift to you with hearts of joy and gratitude and great faith, trusting in your love. And as as we pray every prayer that's on our hearts, Lord, we lift them up in the prayer that you taught us. As we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. 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 All right, you guys can be seated.
So while we get set back up, if you want to hear a funny story about the Tenderloin, ask me about crack pigeons and rule breaking.
Because rule breaking is fun. Okay, here's what we're going to do.
We're going to go into communion, and we're going to make this up as we go along. We're going to go into communion. And then we're going to wrap up with a song that Larry will lead us in. As we're going out, we'll have a couple of our ushers. If you want to give an offering to the church like we normally would, we'll do it that way. You can do that. It's in the rules. And then we'll go into Fellowship Hall and just enjoy fellowship and everything else that God has blessed us with. So does that sound good?
Yes.
I think it sounds great. So let's prepare our hearts. You know, one of the things about this whole trip, and I'm so glad it came out. It wasn't just us, though we're awesome, but it was the communion we shared together as a team, the communion we shared together with just those crazy, wild, wonderful YWAM staff. It was communion we shared at St. Boniface with Tina and Jose and their people. Working so hard. It's communion we share with the sisters. It's communion we shared all throughout with the body of Christ. And I love that about communion. It is our communion with the Lord, and it is our communion with each other. It is a communion that we share as a church and with the big capital C church across God's good creation. So, in the spirit of all that, open your hearts the great joy that our Lord has offered us in this gift of his body and his blood and all that we share in that. Amen? Amen. All right, servers. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you. Thank you for... Oh, hold on one second. Thank you for this table and what is on this table, this bread and this cup, and that they embody your presence in power and gift of grace for us and all that that means in our lives, in our life together, in our life as your church, and in our life eternal. Open our hearts to all of your gifts for us as we share in this great gift. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, he had gathered his disciples together to share in one final meal. And in the midst of that meal, our Lord took bread and he gave thanks for that bread. And then he broke the bread. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, our Lord took the cup. And again, he gave thanks. And he gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, formed for through the shedding of my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink." As we take the body of Christ and of the blood of Christ, let us be mindful of what he has done for us, the great victory that he won for us on the cross. Let us celebrate the great joy of his living, loving, powerful presence with us right now, for he is our living Lord. And let us look with anticipation to that great banquet in the age to come as we celebrate his kingdom. Amen. Please come forward and share in the great meal of our Lord. Scripture says, come and taste and see that the Lord is good. Come and share in that goodness. And if coming forward is difficult for you, Medette would love to bring a cup and the bread to you. So just kind of give her a little sign. All right, please come forward.
Come to the water, you who thirst, and you'll thirst no more. Come to the Father, you who work, and you'll work no more. And all you who labor in vain, and to the broken and shame, love is here, love is now, love is pouring from his hands, from his brow. Love is near, it satisfies, streams of mercy flowing from his side. His love is near. Come to the treasure, you who search, and you'll search no more. Come to the lover you who want, and you'll want no more. And all you who labor in vain, and to the broken and shamed, love is here, love is now. Love is pouring from his hands, from his brow. Love is near, it satisfies. Streams of mercy flowing from his side. Love is here, love is now. Love is pouring from his hands, from his brow. Love is near, it satisfies.
satisfied. Streams of mercy flowing from his side. Streams of mercy flowing from his side. Streams of mercy flowing from his side. 'Cause love is here.
Again, we give you thanks. Thanks for your great faithfulness, the great outpouring of your love that began with the first words of creation, became in such great glory in the life and death and resurrection of your Son. And it surrounds us and empowers us now as we carry your love forward. We thank you for your good gifts and your great faithfulness. And we love you. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
We'll stand and close with one last song. Worship together one more time. Tanner, we'll just go ahead and do God of This City.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are.
You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace in the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. And greater things have yet to come, and greater here. You're the Lord of creation, the creator of all things. You're the King above all kings. You are. You're the strength in the weakness. You are love to the broken. You're the joy in the sadness. You are. For there is no one like our God. There is no one like you, God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Glory shines from hearts alive with praise for you and love for you in this city. And greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. out of this city, you're the king of these people, you're the lord of this nation, and you are.
Amen.
Amen.
This has been an inconvenient morning. And that is awesome. What a great thing to give our time, to give witness and glory to Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior of this world, who is alive and who is present and who is oh so active within us and through us. He wants to do great things. He has done great things. And there's greater things still to come. Isn't that great?
Yes.
I think that's awesome. Thank you for your support. This has been an extraordinary experience, as you've seen, an extraordinary experience in our own lives and for our church, and for so much more. As we hold on to all that God has done and as we look forward to all that God will do, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Heavenly Father, and the presence and power of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Amen. Let's fellowship together. And if you do remember, I'm going to drop an offering on your way out. That'd be awesome.